हेलो स्टूडेंट्स, टुडे आई विल टीच यू फोर्स पार्ट बी. सी, वी हैव कंप्लीटेड पार्ट ए. पार्ट ए इज डन. पार्ट बी एंड पार्ट सी इन दिस चैप्टर फोर्स आर स्मॉल पार्ट्स. ओके, एंड इट हैज एनी फ्यू डेफिनेशंस यू हैव टू लर्न इन देम. देयर वेटेज इज ऑल्सो लेस. सो आई विल कंप्लीट दिस टू पार्ट्स टुडे. But you have to, for the test, you have to focus on part A, force, and full chapter of work and energy. Okay, for the test, this is to be focused upon. This part B and C, only learn the definitions and markings. That would be enough because their weightage is less. But part A of force is very important, and work and energy full chapter is very important. Okay, I've also sent you the notes in the group. Do read them. There may be few questions from there also. Okay, so let's start with part B. The first topic is center of gravity. What is center of gravity? See, let's say we have an object in a shape of a rectangle. Okay, now this is the surface of Earth. The Earth's surface, due to gravity, pulls the object in the downward direction. Any object is pulled towards the center of Earth because of the force of gravity. Okay, so that means this object, let's say object A, is pulled by Earth in the downward direction. That means the Earth is pulling the object from this point in the downward direction, from this point in the downward direction, from every point. See, every point of the object, the Earth is pulling the object in the downward direction. What I am saying is, it is not so that Earth only pulls the right side part of the object, or the left side part of the object, or the center of the object. Earth pulls the entire object down. Pulling the entire object down means each and every point on this object, each and every particle of this object is pulled down. Okay. In the first part, I had explained you, let's say this is a fulcrum on which this rod is balanced. Okay. If I pull the left end of this rod by a force of 100 Newton, what will happen? This rod, if it's kept like this, if I pull it from here, okay, if I pull it from here, this rod will go down in this way. Okay, this part, basically this part will start turning this direction. Okay, it will change like this because I'm pulling it down from here. If I apply the same force from here, if I apply 100 Newton force from here also, see, this force is trying to move this rod in this direction, that is in anti-clockwise direction. This force is trying to rotate the rod in this direction, that is clockwise direction. Okay, so from here it is pulled in anti-clockwise. This force is rotating it in clockwise direction, but both force are same. If both force are same, if you're trying to pull the object, apply the force, same force on both ends, this rod will not change its position. Basically, it is in static equilibrium, which I explained in the earlier part. Okay, so this concept is used here. How? See, when this object is pulled by the Earth, okay, Earth pulls from here with the same force. Okay, let's say the force by which Earth pull is 9.8 Newtons. Okay, this point is also pulled down by 9.8 Newtons. If this both are pulling by 9.8 Newtons, basically this point is trying to rotate the object in this direction, and this point is trying to rotate the object in this direction. So these both force get cancelled. Are you getting me? See, here from this point I'm pulling down, here from this point I'm trying to pull down. From this both points I'm trying to rotate the object, but the force is same, so this both will get cancelled. Similarly, if I am trying to pull the object down from here and from here, okay, these are at equal distances. So this force is also 9.8, this force is also 9.8. Again, these both force will get cancelled. Okay, see, if this is an object, if this is an object here, I'm pulling it down from here and I'm pulling it down from here. Okay, from here and from here. But if these both forces are same, I'll pull from here and here. If the both the forces are same, this pen will not move. Okay, because both the force on both the ends are same. Same thing happens here with the object, that force on each point is cancelled because there is an equal and opposite force on this part. Let's say I'm applying a force from this point in the downward direction. The same force is there on this part, on the opposite end. So these both force will get cancelled. So all the forces here gets cancelled. Only one force remains, that is the force at the center of the object. Okay, see, this point will have a symmetric point here. This point may have a symmetric point here. This point will have a symmetric point here. But the center is only one point. It doesn't have a reflection here and there. So this center, basically, all the forces get cancelled. Only this force remains. Okay. So it is said that Earth pulls the object from its center, from this point. So all the force, all the weight of this object is concentrated on this point. And the Earth pulls this point down. Because of which the entire object, like this, Earth pulls the center point down, the entire object comes down. Okay, object does not come down because of the force applied here or here, because this force is getting cancelled with this force. Okay, but the central force is not getting cancelled. So the object comes down because of this force on the center. This point is called as the center of gravity, where the actual force of gravity applies. Okay, this is called center of gravity. If I read the definition says the center of gravity of a body is a point about which the algebraic sum, this is an important line, the algebraic sum of all the movements, of all movements, you understand movements, movements is force into displacement. So algebraic sum of all the movements of all the particles of the body is zero. Algebraic sum is zero, means this force is getting cancelled with this force, this force is getting cancelled with this force, all the force are getting cancelled. So the algebraic sum of the moments is zero. The entire weight of the body can be considered to act on this point, and hence this point is called as the center of gravity. Okay, so the position of center of gravity of the body, there is a note given below the definition. The position of center of gravity of a body, I'm on page number 13. The position of the center of gravity of a body of a given mass depends on its shape. See, here I had drawn a rectangle, so the center of gravity was here. Okay, if I draw a circle, for example, the center of gravity is here, the center of the circle. If I draw a rod, the center of gravity is here. If I draw a cylinder, the center of gravity is here. For every object, the center of gravity is different. If the object, the shape of an object is different, for example, let's say it is a triangle. Okay, so the center of gravity is somewhere here. A triangular shape, an object, the center of gravity is here. So the center of gravity changes with the shape of an object, and it depends upon the mass of an object. Second is, it is not necessary that the center of gravity always be within the material of the body. See, the second point in the note says that it is not necessary that the center of gravity is within the material of the body. Material of the body means what? For example, see, if there is a circular ring with a border, this is that kind of a ring which we wear on our fingers, this kind of a ring. Okay, this is a ring. This part, let's say, is made up of silver. This is the entire ring. It is hollow from inside. There is nothing here. There is nothing here. There is nothing here. This is the part. This is the metallic part of the ring. Okay, now what is the center of gravity of this ring? The center of gravity of this ring is here. Even though there is no metal here, okay, this is virtual center of gravity, an imaginary point here. Basically, an imaginary point here that the entire ring, when it falls on the earth, okay, its weight is here. This is a virtual, you understand, which you cannot feel, but theoretically, if we try to calculate the center of gravity, it is here in the center of the ring. So whenever, let's say, we have a ring, which I'll explain you with this ring. See, if I have a circular ring like this, okay, and if I, the circular ring falls on the ground, okay, it falls on the grounds. So it falls with its shape flat, horizontal, okay, because the weight is distributed throughout this ring. And the center of gravity of this ring will be the point inside the ring here. Okay, so in the table, figure 1.7 and the table above it, they have given the center of gravity of some regular objects. I want you to learn the center of gravity of all these objects. Here they have given the center of gravity of all objects, out of which few are very important. See, you have to learn this entire paragraph, entire table, but few are very important, like the solid cone, the hollow cone are very important. Center of gravity of a solid cone and a hollow cone at a height h upon 4 from the base. Hollow cone at a height h upon 3 from the base. See, I'll explain you what this h upon 3 and h upon 4 means. Okay, see, a cone, this is the shape of a cone. Okay, hollow cone means, so this is a hollow cone like this, and here they are saying that the center of gravity of a hollow cone is h upon 3 from base. H upon 3 from base means what? See, the height of the cone is calculated. This is the center of the cone and this is the height of the cone. Okay, this height is perpendicular here. This is the height of the cone, h upon 3 from the base. H upon 3, this entire height, name it as h, this is h. And if I break this height into three parts, this is one part, this is two part, and this is three. 1, 2, 3. H upon 3 from the base means 1 upon 3. So the center of gravity is here, h upon 3. H upon 3 means, let's say if the height, for example, the height of the cone is 30. Okay, so h upon 3 from base means 30 upon 3, that is 10 centimeter from base. Okay, so if this entire thing is 30, 10 centimeter from base means 10 centimeter from here, this is the center of gravity. This is 10, this is also 10, this is also 10. So 10 centimeter from base means this point, h upon 3. This was the center of gravity of a hollow cone. Okay, if I draw the center of gravity of a solid cone. See, what is the difference between a solid cone? Solid cone is totally filled inside. There is no empty space inside the cone. Okay, for this type of a cone, a solid cone, the center of gravity changes. If I draw the height here, okay, this height, the center of gravity is h upon 4 from base. H upon 4 from the base means if this is the entire height h, center of gravity is somewhere here, h upon 4 from the base. From the base, like let's say the height is 40 centimeter. Okay, so where will the center of gravity be? H upon 4 means 40 upon 4, 10 centimeter from base. So 10 centimeter from base means I'll start from the base, 10 centimeter here. Here will the center of gravity be for a solid cone. They won't ask you these type of diagrams. You just have to remember the statement here, this, that it is h upon 4 from the base. This was for your understanding. Now, they have given you certain diagrams here. You have to remember them. Now, the next topic is center of gravity and the balance point. See, you are able to balance certain objects, like for example, if there is a scale, a meter scale, you can balance a meter scale from its midpoint easily. Okay, you can balance a meter scale from the midpoint. Why are you able to balance that meter scale? Because that midpoint is nothing but the center of gravity of that scale. That is why you are able to balance it. Okay, any object can be balanced from its point, center of gravity from its the midpoint of the object, that is the center of gravity. You can balance that object from that point. Okay. Now, in this part, the last topic is determining the center of gravity. Determining the center of gravity of irregular object. Determining the center of gravity of an irregular object. See, these were objects which we studied, this cone, hollow cone, then a rectangle or a circle or a square. These are regular objects. A regular object means objects whose area, whose volume is known to us by formulas. But what if I give you an irregular object? Let's say an object like this, and I tell you to find the center of gravity of that object. So there's an entire experiment shown in the textbook. See, here it is given in your textbook, this diagram. Okay, this is the experiment. Although the note which is given in the end of the part is most important here, this note. This part is just for your reading purpose, but I'll explain you. See, now how to find the center of gravity of this object? Let's say this is an irregular object. Okay, see, the shape of the object is not regular, it is not a square, it is not a rectangle, some irregular shape. Okay, and I have named it a lamina. Lamina means an object with irregular shape. It's a piece, it's a shape basically. Lamina means irregular shape. So here, if I have a lamina and I want to find the center of gravity of this, okay, how will I do it? First, on a rigid support with a thread, I will tie this with a thread. I will make a hole here. See, I'll make a hole here and I'll tie this here with a thread. Okay, once I tie, it will like this, it will start hanging here. Wait, I'll just draw a border here for you to understand. See, this is an object. If I tie the object here, okay, this is a string. I'll try this irregular shape lamina here. Okay. Now, once I tie it here, it will start moving like this and then it will settle at one position. Okay. Let's say it settled here like this. So, I'll draw a straight line from here from this object. Then I'll turn the lamina. I'll make a hole here. Okay. Again, I'll tie it with the string. Okay. Again, it will move for some time and then it will rest, let's say, in this position. Okay. Once it rests in this position, I'll again draw a straight line with this reference. Okay. Then I'll make a hole in this point. Then I'll again tie it with a string. Okay. It will move like this and then settle on, let's say, like this. Okay. Then I'll again draw a straight line with this reference. Are you getting me? I'm making hole on each corners. Okay. Then I'm tying it with a string. This is a rigid support. This is a string. Okay. I tied it with the string. So it will get attached like this. Now, the next point. So basically, I've covered four corners. See, as many corners as I can, I'll try doing that. For example, if I take this corner, the remaining corner, I'll attach it here. Okay. And it will move like this for some time. Once I attach it, then it will settle. Okay. Once it settles, with this reference, I'll draw a line like this. And then I observe that all these lines which I have drawn from the corners are intersecting at one point. This point is the center of gravity of that object. Okay. So this is how we find the center of gravity of an irregular lamina. Next. Now we'll start with part C. Uniform circular motion. Okay. What is uniform circular motion? First, when an object is moving with a constant speed in a circular path, in 9th standard you have studied this topic in motion in one dimension. That, for example, if a car is moving in a circular direction continuously like this, okay, with a constant speed, let's say the speed is 50 kmph, kilometers per hour, it is constantly moving in this direction, then it is said to be in uniform circular motion. Okay. One thing you have to understand, that when an object is moving in a uniform circular motion, it is constantly changing its direction. See, at this point the object was in this direction, at this point I can say the object is in this direction, at this point it was in this direction, the car, let's say here it is in this direction, here it is pointing on this direction, this point here. So at every point you can see the direction is changing. Okay, direction is changing means, see, there are two quantities, there is speed and there is velocity. Speed depends upon the magnitude is 50 kmph, okay, but velocity depends upon the magnitude and direction, because velocity is a vector quantity, speed is a scalar quantity. So magnitude here is 50 kmph, which is constant, but the direction is changing continuously. Okay, so I can say that this motion has constant speed, but this motion doesn't have constant velocity, it has variable velocity. Why variable velocity? Because the magnitude is constant, but the direction is continuously changing. If the direction is changing, object is said to be in variable velocity. Using this thing, on the next page, on page number 16, the first topic you have, difference between uniform circular motion and uniform linear motion. Uniform circular motion and uniform linear motion, you have a topic there. So this was uniform circular motion, okay, and uniform linear motion means what? That a car is moving in a straight path. Okay, if the car is moving in a straight path, let's say this is my car, it is moving in a straight path like this with a speed of 50 kilometers per hour in east direction. Correct. So the speed is 50 continuously and the direction is east. That means the direction is not changing and the speed is also not changing. Both are constant. If the both are constant, it is going in a straight line. I call it uniform linear motion. Linear means straight line. Okay. So here there is no acceleration. See, acceleration depends upon the velocity. What is the formula for acceleration? Acceleration formula is change in velocity upon time. This is the formula for acceleration. Change in velocity upon time. In this case, uniform linear motion, speed is the 50 kilometers per hour is not changing. Direction is also not changing. Both are not changing. That means velocity is constant. If velocity is constant, there is no acceleration. Okay. But in uniform circular motion, there is variable velocity. Velocity is changing continuously. So this uniform circular motion is accelerated motion. The acceleration is not zero. Okay. See, few of you might get confused that there is no change in speed. Speed is 50 only. 50 kmph. Okay. Then how is the vehicle accelerated? See, acceleration does not only mean that speed is increasing. Okay. Even if the direction is changing, the object is said to be accelerated. Okay. Because acceleration depends on variable velocity. And variable velocity means speed is constant, but direction is changing. Okay. Now next, So the last topic is centripetal and centrifugal force. Okay, first understand what is centripetal force. Okay, now every circular motion, every circular motion is because of the centripetal force. Centripetal force is something which is pulling the object inside. Okay, let's example, we have sun and around the sun we have planets revolving. Okay, see, around the sun, let's say this is earth. Earth is constantly revolving around the sun. Why is earth constantly on this path? Why is it not going outside from here? Or it is leaving its path and going outside from here? No, earth is not changing its path. Why is earth not changing its path? Because sun is constantly pulling earth towards itself. Okay, there is a force of attraction between the sun and the earth, which is keeping the earth from going outside. Okay. Let's take another example. If I have a string, this is a string, and I tie a stone. This is a stone. I tied a stone to the string. Okay. And I try to rotate the string like this fast. Okay. The stone will also rotate along with the string. For example, see this. You can see this girl here is holding the string and it is revolving this. There is a stone or a bob tied to the string and she is revolving it in the circular direction. Okay, this is constantly revolving it in the circular direction like this, the stone. So constantly, see, if she leaves this string, this ball will go outside. The ball will not follow this path anymore and it will go outside. Okay, but the ball is following this path because she has constantly pulled it towards the center of the circle. She is constantly pulling the ball inside. That is why the ball is revolving, but it is not changing its path. Okay, this pull in the inward direction by this girl is called as the centrifugal force. This pull, see, she is constantly pulling the ball inside. Like if I have another example, if I take, let's say this is a nucleus of an atom, okay, and I have electrons revolving around the nucleus. Okay, these electrons are constantly revolving around the nucleus. They are not leaving their path. Why? Because the nucleus is positive in nature. This electron is negative and there is an electrostatic force between them, which pulls them inside, pulls these electrons inside and doesn't allow them to leave the path or go outside. So this pull, which keeps something inside, the inward pull, is called as the centripetal force. What is centripetal force? Centripetal force is the inward pull to any object. Okay, now the opposite to that is centrifugal force. What was centripetal? Inward force. What is centrifugal? Outward force. Outward force. But centrifugal force is a fictitious force. What does fictitious means? Fictitious means imaginary, virtual, not real. Fictitious force means imaginary, virtual, not real. Centrifugal force is not a real force. Okay, I'm sorry, I wrote fugal again. Centrifugal force is not a real force. Okay, it is a fictitious imaginary force. Now, how does it work? See, let's say this is sun earth is here and they are revolving in, earth is revolving around the sun in this path, okay? Suddenly, if something happens, the gravity of the sun reduces to zero. Something happens, a hypothetical situation, that the gravity of the sun becomes zero. Sun is no more attracting the earth towards itself. Earth is in a very high speed. You must understand that earth is revolving around the sun at a great speed. Okay, so it is constantly revolving around the sun at this great speed, and suddenly the inward pull stopped. So now there is no inward pull, so earth will no more follow this path. It will leave and it will go whichever direction it was. If it was here, it will start moving in this direction because there is no inward pull. No one is pulling them here. If the earth was here, it may start going in the straight direction from here. It will no more come here. Why? Because there is no inward pull from the sun. Okay, that means earth is going here. Because earth is going here, we say that this outward movement of the earth, okay, outward movement of the earth is because of something is pulling the earth from here, and that pull is caused by the force which is called as centrifugal force. Okay, see, actually there is no force here, actually no one is pulling the earth, but this force is nothing but the consequence of what? Absence of centripetal force. If there is no inward pulling force, automatically the earth will go out. Okay, so the earth is going out in this direction. We say that there is a virtual imaginary force here which is pulling the earth. Okay, and that force is centrifugal force. Okay, like for example, if you are in a merry-go-round, okay, let's say this is where you sit in a merry-go-round. All these small vehicles which are there in the merry-go-round are attached like this. Okay, now this, when the merry-go-round is moving constantly, all these vehicle along with you are moving in the merry-go-round. Suddenly, if this attached, let's say a rod or a string by which you are attached to the merry-go-round, breaks, what will happen? This your vehicle or the let's say whatever shape in which you are sitting will no more follow this path and will go here and maybe fall down. Okay, so something pulled this. Okay, that force which pulls this object outside is called as the centrifugal force. Okay, actually there was no force here. You have to understand, centrifugal force is an imaginary force. So because the string broke, nothing was there to pull the object inside, so automatically the object will go outside, and this, it went outside. So we say that there was a force, centrifugal force, which pulled this object outside. Okay, so here you have to study the definition of centrifugal and centripetal force. Then you have to study this difference between uniform circular motion and uniform linear motion. Okay, that's it with fourth chapter. All the best for your test.